Wetlands Center, and today I'm going to tell you guys about abiotic controlling factors in an aquatic ecosystem. So what do you think an abiotic factor actually is? Okay, good news, I'll tell you. An abiotic factor is a non-living thing that controls parts of an ecosystem. An aquatic ecosystem is an ecosystem that is in the water, like the one right behind me. So we are going to talk about five different abiotic factors. The first one we're going to go over is going to be salinity. I have Jose here. He also works at the Wetlands Center, and he's going to be demonstrating each test for us. So the first one we're going to do is salinity. Salinity is how salty or not salty the water is. We have three different levels. We have fresh water, brackish water, and salt water. And we're going to find out what we have right here behind us. So we're going to start with our refractometer. The refractometer is a tool that tells us how salty or not salty the water is by taking a little pipette, filling it up with water, and dropping it on the prism of this little device, a little blue screen. And then we look inside of it like a telescope, like we'll see in a second. And then from there, we can see the measurement. Yep, right now we have a salinity of about 4 parts per thousand. That means that we have brackish water behind us. Sometimes it gets a little bit higher, sometimes it can be fresh water. It just depends on the conditions around us, like if it's been raining a lot or what the tide is doing. So that is salinity. We have brackish water here in Baytown, usually, depending on where we're at. The next one that we're going to talk about is temperature. So temperature is pretty simple. It's how hot or how cold something is. Right now, it is neither hot nor cold, so we're going to find out the actual temperature of it outside. We're going to use a thermometer with that. Down here at the bottom, we have little holes, and that's going to tell us, that's going to take the temperature. So we're going to hold it here for about 10 seconds and let it find out. We're doing science, so we're going to be using degrees Celsius instead of Fahrenheit. So outside, it looks like it's about 29 degrees Celsius, which if I had to guess is maybe like 75 degrees Fahrenheit. And now we are going to test the water. The water temperature and the air temperature might be a little bit different because water has a higher specific heat than the air. That means it takes more energy to change the temperature of the water. Now, the temperature of an ecosystem is pretty important because certain animals can't live in certain temperatures. Like if you put a polar bear in the desert, he would not be very happy. Also, the birds fly south for the winter because of the temperature. So it definitely has an impact on migration patterns as well. 24? All right, so it looks like it's about 24 degrees Celsius. It's a little bit cooler in the water than it is in the air, which is completely normal because at night it gets a little chilly lately since we're still in like the early springtime. I don't know when spring began. We're in spring. All right, so that is temperature. It's about 75 degrees or 29 degrees Celsius. Now the next test that we're gonna do is dissolved oxygen. So dissolved oxygen is how much oxygen that we have in the water. We should probably have a pretty good amount of oxygen in the water so our organisms can breathe. It is very important that we have enough oxygen because everybody needs to breathe, right? So the way we do this is we take a little graduated cylinder, we fill it up with water. There we go. And then we have little ampoules. With our ampoules, we take one and we put it into the graduated cylinder with the pointy side down. And then we can feel it kind of wedge in there, and then we pull it like a lever and then it'll break. That's what we want. And then we kind of stir around a little bit and then we'll see a color change in the ampoule. It's really pretty neat. Now, if we don't have enough oxygen in the water, that can become a really big problem because without enough oxygen, nobody can breathe, right? So that is called a dead zone. Dead zone is whenever there is no oxygen in the water and it's not a very lively atmosphere. Now the way we measure this is we have a little chart right here and then we compare it to the different colors on the chart, and it has a scale on it, and then whichever one it matches the best is going to be the measurement of our dissolved oxygen. Yep, I agree. So we have about 8 parts per million with our dissolved oxygen in our water. Now the next test that we're gonna do, the next abiotic factor that we're gonna measure is pH. Now pH is how acidic or how basic a substance is. I don't think that we want acidic water because that's like lemon juice and tomato juice, that's kind of gross. We also don't want basic water because that's like bleached substances. We want our water to be at about 7, which is neutral. We want neutral water. So we are gonna find out by filling up a little test tube with water. By the way, our test water came from right out here in our Goose Creek. Now once we have our water in our little test tube, we are gonna take a piece of litmus paper off of a little roll, about an inch. And we're gonna drop it into our little test tube of water. We're gonna give it a little bit of a stir. We're gonna wait for it to change color. And inside of our box, there's a little chart. I'm gonna give it a little against this chart and we're gonna check it out. About 7. So our water is neutral. That's exactly what we wanted, so that's good. So our last test, our last abiotic factor that we're gonna talk about is turbidity. That's a fun word to say, turbidity. Turbidity refers to how much suspended sediments are in the water. So that means basically how cloudy the water is. So why do we want a good level of turbidity? We don't want our water to be too cloudy because can the organisms see in cloudy water? Not so well. Can they really breathe all that great if they're ingesting all of these suspended sediments and dust and stuff? Not so much. And can the plants at the bottom get the sunlight that they need if the water is too cloudy? Not really. So there's all kinds of little problems that can happen whenever our water is too turbid. But a lot of organisms are adapted to live in certain levels of turbidity, but if it changes, that may not be some good news. So this is a turbidity tube. This is a turbidity tube. This is gonna measure how cloudy our water is. At the bottom, there's a little black and white Secchi disc. Whenever there's no water in it, we can see it, but whenever we fill the water up to a certain level, you're not gonna be able to see it. So that's why we start pressing down. Make sure you have it on a seam so it doesn't get stuck. Right here. We're gonna start pressing down and then we'll see the water recede in the tube. And then at one point, we're gonna be able to see the black and white Secchi disc at the bottom, even very, very, very vaguely. But if we can see it, that's when we stop pressing. Turbidity is about 12 centimeters. That means that the sun can reach 12 centimeters in the water before it stops being able to travel through the water, before the light stops reaching through. Which is fine. If we had a higher number, that would mean that our water was less turbid because more sun can travel further through the water. So that is turbidity, and those are our 5 abiotic factors, our non-living factors that control parts of our ecosystem. In an aquatic ecosystem, which is a water ecosystem like we have behind us. Thanks for listening.